Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Ancient Celts, Second Edition, by Barry Cunliffe, narrated by Julian Elfer. Preface to the Second Edition. The first edition of this book was written 20 years ago when the subject, indeed the validity of the Celts, was being actively debated. Most archaeologists were agreed that our perceptions of the ancient Celts, which had changed little over the last century, were in urgent need of revision. A certain nostalgic coziness had crept in, and although new data was accumulating fast, there had been little critical debate. Old mantras about Celticness were repeated, bringing comfort rather than stimulation. In the debate that followed in the 1990s and the early years of this millennium, the way in which the concept of the Celt had been constructed was energetically reassessed. Old preconceptions were cast off, and new ways were developed to try to improve our understanding of the European barbarians, who were referred to as Celts or Gauls by their Mediterranean neighbours. What became clear early in the debate was that the models we had been using were no longer fit for purpose. They were predicated on a theory, first coherently formulated in the early 18th century, to explain variations in a language group to which the name Celtic had been given. It was not until the early 19th century that the nascent discipline of archaeology began slowly to yield relevant data. Since philology was the senior discipline, the findings of the archaeologists were inevitably interpreted in terms of the linguistic model. So it was until the last decades of the 20th century when it began to become apparent that the archaeological evidence could no longer be forced to fit the old linguistic theories. It was in this atmosphere of newfound confidence that some archaeologists began to consider fresh models, suggesting that the Celtic language may have originated in the Atlantic zone of Europe and may have spread eastwards, perhaps as early as the 3rd millennium BC. The discussion has continued over the last 15 years or so, some groups trying to find a rapprochement between archaeologists and linguists. Now, with the development of new techniques to extract ancient DNA from human bones, an entirely new source of data is becoming available, totally independently of archaeology and linguistics. Once sufficient ancient DNA evidence becomes available and is brought into meaningful juxtaposition with the archaeological data, reliable narratives of human mobility, exploring both connectivity and remoteness, will be able to be constructed for Europe. These will challenge linguists to look anew at their long-held theories. Out of all this, the history of the people who spoke the Celtic language will emerge. These are exciting times. The exploration of the Celts, then, is a worthwhile pursuit, since it draws us deep into the processes which help us to begin to understand the complexity of our past. Barry Cunliffe, Oxford, December 2017. Preface to the First Edition. For 2,500 years, the Celts have continued to fascinate those who have come into contact with them. For the Greeks and Romans, the fascination was tinged with fear, tempered with a degree of respect for Celtic prowess in battle. Later generations, further removed from the reality of the barbarian Celts of the 1st millennium BC, generated their own myths and stereotypes about the past, recreating Celtic ancestors for themselves in the image of the day designed to explain their own attitudes and aspirations and to provide a legitimacy for actions. The study of the Celts and of our changing visions of them offer an incomparable insight into the human need to establish an identity, and of the difficulties which this poses to archaeologists who, by their best endeavours, attempt to remain objective. It could be argued that biased historical anecdotes, ill-understood patterns of early language development, and hard archaeological facts, the artifacts, eco-facts, and structures of the past recovered through excavation, should not, and indeed cannot, be brought together to create a coherent picture of the past. The position is firmly taken by some and energetically argued. It is not one with which I have much sympathy. Given an array of disparate evidence, we would, I believe, be failing if we were to fight shy of the challenges posed by using every available scrap in our attempt to construct a European proto-history. In doing so, we will inevitably be drawn into simplification and generalization, laying ourselves open to criticism from the purists, but better the attempt to create a whole, however imperfect, than to be satisfied with the minute examination of only a part. In writing this book, within the entirely reasonable constraints suggested by the publishers, I have found it impossible to go into areas of detail which I would like to have covered, while at the same time being drawn into the wider themes of European pre- and proto-history. Rather than adhere to the preconceptions of my original plan, I have allowed myself to be led by the subject. What emerges is much less an archaeology than it might have been. My other indulgence is to have written the text during a sabbatical term living in a house on the north coast of Brittany, overlooking a narrow bay to the headland of Le Jude beyond. In the late Iron Age, the promontory was defended by a massive rampart, and it is quite conceivable, though yet unproven, that it was one of the communities attacked by Caesar in 56 BC. Living here in Brittany has provided a constant reminder of the Celtic world. In the nearby church at Lugivy-les-Lagnon, we attended a musical celebration for the pardon of St. Ivy. The long address of welcome was in Breton, then followed music and singing, dominated by bagpipes and bombards identical to those played by the shepherds in the adoration depicted on the 17th century altarpiece above. 2 months later, in July, the local fête folklorique was held within the promontory fort of Le Jude. The event is an entirely new creation, only some 10 years old, but it is fast becoming a focus for the community. The displays of old farm machinery and ancient crafts are as fascinating to the local population as they are to the tourists, and in the evening, as dinner in the open air proceeds, old and young alike join in the singing of Breton songs and the dancing, and listen to the telling of stories. It is, of course, a conscious recreation of a past, but a past not long gone, and one which offers a much-needed sense of identity and continuity in a fast-changing world. The archaeology of Le Jude, the Breton language still spoken, and the underlying sense of a Celtic ethnicity are aspects of the phenomenon of the Celts. In their coherence and disparity, they provide a leitmotif for the book to follow. Finally, a few acknowledgements to the editorial and design departments of Oxford University Press for their help and advice throughout. To the many individuals and institutions who provided photographs, to Alison Wilkins for producing a new series of line drawings, to Linda Smithson for preparing the text, and to my family for their forbearance and understanding with my mild obsession. Barry Cunliffe, Pont Roux, January 1996. 1. Visions of the Celts. In a famous lecture given more than half a century ago, the Oxford scholar J.R.R. Tolkien chided his audience, mostly comprised of Celtic specialists, by claiming, "Celtic of any sort is a magic bag into which anything may be put and out of which almost anything may come. Anything is possible in the fabulous Celtic twilight, which is not so much a twilight of the gods as of the reason." He was specifically referring to linguistic etymologies, but his words were true for Celtic studies in general, which, after nearly 300 years of introspection, had created a tissue of self-sustaining myths far removed from the reality of the available data. By throwing into the magic bag scraps gleaned from linguistics, classical sources, vernacular literature, archaeology and art history, and seasoning the mix with a dash of nationalism and no small amount of wishful thinking, there emerged resplendent the image of the Celt, an image fashioned by the needs and aspirations of those who created it. When Tolkien's lecture was published in the early 1960s, archaeologists were already beginning to feel uncomfortable with the generalized concept of Celtic society then broadly accepted, and in particular with some of the invasionist theories inherent in the traditional narrative. Indeed, some believed that the terms Celt and Celtic should be avoided altogether because they had led to distortions in the way the archaeological record was interpreted and presented. One writer regarded the ancient Celts of Britain and Ireland as a bogus and recent invention. Behind these early Celto-skeptic debates lurked an entirely different question. When and where did the Celtic language originate? The traditional view of Celtic origins was that Celtic culture emerged in the early 1st millennium BC, towards the end of the Late Bronze Age in West Central Europe, the implication being that the language developed at the same time, and that it was from this homeland Celtic language and culture spread south, east, and west to encompass much of the European peninsula. In the 1990s, an alternative hypothesis began to be considered. that the language developed much earlier in the Atlantic zone, perhaps as a lingua franca, and spread eastwards into the West and Central Europe during a period of mobility characterized by the beaker phenomenon in the middle of the 3rd millennium. The debate is still continuing, and these are questions to which we will return. The subject of the ancient Celts, then, is one that generates much lively discussion. In this chapter, we will consider how the concept of the Celt has come into being and how it has changed over the last 2,500 years. Classical sources and archaeology. The first reference to the Celts in Europe is found in the work of the Greek geographer Hecataeus of Miletus, writing at the end of the 6th century BC. Thereafter, the Celts are mentioned with increasing frequency by Greek and Roman writers. Without their descriptions and speculations, our understanding of the Celts, the Iron Age communities of Central and Western Europe, would be very different. Alone, the mute archaeological evidence would allow us to sketch a warrior society focused in West Central Europe, its aristocracy demonstrating its prowess through elaborately equipped burials. Over the period from the 8th to the 5th century, different ways of displaying status were introduced. We would be able to recognize growing links with classical cultures of the Western Mediterranean, reaching a new intensity in the period from the mid-6th to the mid-5th century BC, after which local schools of fine metalwork, using concepts and techniques learned partly from the Mediterranean world, developed to serve the elite. The archaeological evidence would amply demonstrate the emergence of a more warlike society by the 4th century, whose values and technology, reflected in the material culture recovered from cemeteries, spread across much of Europe, from northern France to Romania, and from Poland to the Po Valley. Towards the end of the 2nd century and throughout the 1st, in the decades preceding the Roman expansion, we would observe an intensification in production and exchange over much of the central area, focusing on large nucleated settlements, many of them defended, which were beginning to appear at this time. If we stood back and took a broader geographical perspective, it would become immediately clear that at any one time there was considerable cultural variation from one area to another. We would be able to identify core zones of innovation and intensification and peripheries in which these developments were reflected with decreasing clarity as distance from the core increased. What we would not be able to appreciate with any degree of certainty is the long period of conflict between the Celtic communities of the Po Valley and the Roman world, and we would be largely ignorant of the violent raids of the Celts deep into Greece in the 3rd century BC and of the large-scale migrations of communities from the Middle Danube into the heart of Asia Minor which followed. Nor would we have in our minds visions of white-robed druids cutting mistletoe with golden sickles when the moon was just at the right stage of its cycle, or of harsh-voiced warrior queens with waist-length golden hair, or of feasting warriors slurping their wine through drooping moustaches while boasting outrageously of their prowess. Unlike the archaeological evidence, the classical sources provide a narrative and action. They offer us a range of characters with a large supporting cast whose achievements and failures are fascinating to follow. While the purest archaeologist might argue that one should study the Iron Age communities of Europe only through the archaeological data, since the classical sources, by their inevitable partiality and deliberate manipulation, distort our understanding, to reject such a rich vein of anecdote would be defeatist. It would admit to an inability to treat the written sources critically. The Greek and Roman authors have provided us with their own vision of the Celts, a vision born of contemporary or near-contemporary experience. That vision has pervaded Celtic studies for 2,000 years and cannot be ignored. The Greco-Roman vision. Classical observers refer to the continental Celts by a variety of names. The Roman historians writing of the migrations from north of the Alps to the Po Valley and beyond called them Galli, and this tradition was followed by Polybius, to whom they were Galatei, a name also commonly used in other Greek sources. Most of the 1st century BC writers, however, realized that these names were interchangeable with the Greek Celtoi and Latin Celtae. Indeed, Caesar, writing of the inhabitants of central Gaul, specifically says, "We call them Gauls, though in their own language they are called Celts." The 2nd century AD Greek writer Pausanias also stressed that Celtoi was a more long-established term than Galli. The simplest way to explain this apparent confusion would be to accept that Celtoi was the general name by which the broad sweep of peoples stretching from north of the Alps to Iberia were known to the classical world and knew themselves, and that Galli-Galatei was a specific term applied to those tribes among them that chose to migrate to the south and southeast. Caesar's statement, "We call them Gauls," may be interpreted as implying that the term had a Mediterranean origin. One possibility is that it comes from an Indo-European word meaning stranger or enemy, in which case it can hardly be an ethnonym. Knowledge of the Celts grew slowly up to the 4th century BC. The geographer Hecateus had access to some information about the Celts. He was aware that the Greek colony of Massalia, founded about 600 BC, lay in the land of the Ligurians near the territory of the Celts, and that the settlement of Narbo, Narbonne, was Celtic. Hecateus thus firmly establishes the presence of Celts in southern Gaul in the late 6th century. Elsewhere he mentions Nyrax as a Celtic city. No certain identification can be offered, but Noreia in Austria has been favoured by some commentators. Herodotus of Halicarnassus, writing in the early 5th century BC, makes reference to the Celts in his histories, though he admits that his information about the West is imperfect. He provides three geographical observations: that the source of the Danube is in the land of the Celts, that the river rises near the Celtic city of Pyrene, and that the Celts lived west of the Pillars of Hercules, the Strait of Gibraltar, next to the Kynatoi, who were the westernmost peoples of Europe. Thus, Herodotus's informants seem to have believed that there were Celts living in both southwest Iberia and Middle Europe. The mention of Pyrene as being near the source of the Danube does, however, present a difficulty since it is assumed to be related geographically to the Pyrenees, some suggesting it to be the port of Emporion, Asturias. Herodotus's confused geography is unlikely to be resolved. By the 4th century, the Greeks had come to accept that the Celts occupied a large swath of Western Europe from Iberia to the Upper Danube.
Ephorus regarded them as one of the four great barbarian peoples of the world, along with the Scythians, Persians, and Libyans.
In this, he was reflecting the broad general model which helped the Greeks to explain the nature of the periphery beyond the civilized Mediterranean core. Strabo, writing more than 200 years later, said that Ephorus believed Celtica to be so large that it included most of Iberia as far west as Gadir, Cadiz. It was during the 4th century that more detailed information about the Celtic peoples began to accumulate, when Celtic bands, settlers, raiders, and mercenaries, became involved in the politics and military affairs of the Mediterranean. Knowledge of the large-scale migration of Celts from north of the Alps to the Po Valley, circa 400, and of subsequent raids southwards against Rome and beyond beginning in circa 390, soon reached the Greek world, where Celtic warriors, along with Iberians, began to be employed as mercenary troops in the war between the Spartans and Thebes in 367 BC. Thus, when Plato in his Laws describes the Celts as warlike and hard-drinking, he may have been relying on first-hand experience rather than simply repeating a stereotype of barbarians. Aristotle clearly had access to a number of sources on which to base his generalized comments about Celtic peoples, and he was certainly aware of the attack on Rome. For him, the Celts were a hardy northern people. They exposed their children to their harsh climate with little clothing in order to toughen them, and excessive obesity among them was punished. They were warlike, ferocious, and fearless to the point of irrationality. The men took little notice of their women and rather preferred male company, and they had strict rules of hospitality, especially to strangers. A lost text, Magicus, sometimes ascribed to Aristotle, is said to mention the existence of druids and holy men among the Celts and Galatae.
The Aristotelian stereotype is a compound of anecdotal scraps presented within a vision of how barbarians ought to be.
The balance of fact and prejudice is difficult to assess, but as noted, the range of information available from first-hand observation had greatly increased during the 4th century, and it would be surprising if Aristotle had not used it with judgment and discretion. While the intrusion of Celtic peoples into the Mediterranean world increased the familiarity of the classical world with them, expeditions, such as that undertaken by Pythias of Massalia in circa 320, will have broadened the knowledge base still further. Pythias sailed along the Atlantic seaways in a voyage of discovery, his curiosity no doubt inspired by economic considerations. He describes the Armorican Peninsula, which he considered to be a part of Celticae, before going on to explore the coasts of Britain, perhaps even venturing still further north. For him, the British Isles lay north of the land of the Celts and were known as the Britannic Islands. There is no suggestion that he regarded the Brittany as Celtic. In parallel with the scientific discoveries of men like Pythias and the philosophical considerations of Aristotle, Greek mythology expanded to take account of the Celts. According to Timaeus, they were descended either from the union of Polyphemus and Galatea or from the giant Keltos. Another version sees the Galatians as the descendants of Galatos, the son of Cyclops and Galatea. A different tradition assigns the fatherhood of Galatos or Keltos to Heracles, who, during his wanderings in the west, was seduced by Keltine, the beautiful daughter of King Bretonos. Unable to resist her charms and to overcome her reluctance to give him back the cattle of Geryon, he felt impelled to sleep with her. The Celts were brought into much sharper focus for the Romans and Greeks during the 4th and 3rd centuries BC as hordes of warriors, sometimes accompanied by migrating communities, thrust their way into Italy, Greece, and Asia Minor. For Rome, the dangerous conflict lasted from the initial advance southwards towards Rome soon after 400 BC to the decisive Battle of Telamon in 225. The Greek confrontation was shorter-lived, centering on the invasion of 280 to 278, which culminated in an attack on Delphi. In Asia Minor, the Hellenistic and Roman armies were to confront Galatians throughout the century or so after the migration from Europe in the aftermath of their abortive Greek expedition. It was during these two centuries that the Celtic stereotype was to acquire its familiar form. They were unrestrained, fearless warriors, irrationally brave in the first onslaught, but prone to wild despair if the battle turned against them. Unpredictable and unreliable as allies, they could easily be aroused to battle fury, but could quickly become too drunk or too paralyzed by superstitious fear to fight. And above all, they were barbarians, people of alien behavior, cruel and prone to such savagery as human sacrifice and even cannibalism. It is easy to see in this broad sketch, a sketch which any Greek or Roman schoolboy might have been expected to turn out, a stereotypical, almost timeless description of the enemy from without, and yet beneath its simplistic exaggeration lie some elements of the truth learned from the bitter experience of two centuries of confrontation and conflict. The historians of Greece and Rome, writers such as Polybius, Livy, and Pausanias, were all attempting to project particular images of history. Their individual presentations of the Celt were necessarily conditioned by this, but the common thread which they wished to communicate was of their own systems triumphing over fearsome forces from without, the rational, civilized order of the state contrasted with the wild, savage chaos of the primitive barbarians. It was, therefore, the antitheses of the ideals of Greco-Roman civilization that were emphasized in the classical accounts of the Celts. To point up the classical achievement, however, the enemy had also to be seen as a worthy opponent, fearless in battle and with a savage nobility that made his defeat the more remarkable. These attitudes come together in the dramatic visual reality of contemporary sculpture. The violent savagery of Gauls looting a temple is brilliantly portrayed in a sculptured frieze of the 2nd century BC from Civitalba, Ancona, but the power and nobility of the Celt is nowhere better captured than on the victory monuments erected by the Attalid kings at Pergamum and at Athens in the 3rd and 2nd centuries BC. The Acropolis monument at Pergamum, commissioned by Attalus I in the 220s, is known to us only from later Roman marble copies. The famous Dying Gaul, a Gaulish warrior committing suicide beside his dead wife, and the head of a bearded Gaul. Together they convey the vision of an enemy one could be proud to have defeated. The Pergamene kingdom as the savior of Hellenism is the theme displayed in an even more dramatic form in a victory monument erected on the Acropolis of Athens after the final defeat of the Gauls between 168 and 166 BC. Here, according to Pausanias, the Pergamene defeat of the Gauls in Asia Minor was presented in parallel with the Greek victory over the Persians at Marathon, and both were balanced with mythological battles, the Greeks against the Amazons, and the ancestors of the Pergamenes against the giants. The claim of the Attalids was, thus, blatant. They, like the Greeks, have throughout time been the saviors of civilization against the external forces of chaos and destruction. The allusion was already there in the hymn to Delos written by Callimachus, who lived at the time of the Celtic attack on Delphi, in which the Celts are likened to latter-day Titans. Of the many Gauls who would have been depicted among the 100 or so statues that formed the monument, 5 survive in Roman marble copies, 1 in the Louvre in Paris, 1 in Naples, and 3 in Venice. All are portrayed at their moment of defeat as cowed by the might of their conquerors. A similar message was conveyed by the great frieze carved around the outside of the altar of Zeus at Pergamum, showing Zeus and Athena defeating the giants, while the Attalids defeat the Gauls. Here again, the Pergamene rulers are claiming to be the heroes who saved the civilized world. In these remarkable survivals, the classical vision of the Celts, as it was perceived by those with the power to purvey their own version of history and its messages, stands out in sharp focus. Once created, it has remained in the consciousness of all subsequent observers. With the threat of the Celts as a force for destruction receding in the 2nd century, a somewhat different metaphor began to develop. The most informative source is the work of Posidonius, a Syrian Greek from Apamea. Posidonius wrote a series of histories in 52 books, beginning his narrative in the mid-2nd century to follow on from the histories of Polybius. Book 23 contained an ethnographical introduction about the Celts as a background to the Roman conquest of Transalpina, completed in 121 BC. For this, he had access to a variety of earlier sources augmented by his own travels in Gaul. The information at his disposal then comprised much anecdotal material reflecting earlier times, which he was able to present alongside his own more systematic observations. The histories are no longer extant, but were extensively used, sometimes with direct acknowledgement, by 3 later writers: Strabo, Diodorus Siculus, and Athenaeus, and they may also have been used by Julius Caesar as a source for the ethnographic descriptions in his Book 6 of the Gallic War. Posidonius was a Stoic philosopher and, as Athenaeus tells us, in describing the customs of many peoples, he composed his work in accordance with his philosophical convictions. In essence, Posidonius believed that contemporary barbarian peoples reflected a condition closer to the Golden Age than civilized societies, and that in that Golden Age, people were ruled by the wise. To this extent, his account of the Celts has something of a rosy glow about it. Thus, he approves of their bravery and of their honouring of the brave, and comments favourably upon their hospitality to strangers. He excuses their fondness for war and their impetuous nature, saying that they were really a straightforward people and not of evil character. He even came to terms with the idea of Celtic headhunting. They were, in fact, only like boisterous schoolchildren. To the frankness and high-spiritedness of their temperament must be added the traits of childish boastfulness and love of decoration. But they were ruled by wisdom because among those specially honoured and given authority were the Druids, who were the natural and moral philosophers and men of science. They are believed to be the most just of men. In his Celtic ethnography, Posidonius can fairly be accused of being a soft primitivist, who shielded himself and his readers from the realities of Celtic societies. This same attitude is evident in the works of the Alexandrian school from the 1st century AD onwards, which, using written sources rather than field observation, present Celtic religion and Druidism as on a par with Pythagorean systems. From the middle of the 1st century BC, a new sense of reality was instilled by writers such as Caesar, Lucan, and Tacitus, who reported on the conquest of the Gauls and the Britons. Although there was some recourse to the old stereotypes for the standard ethnographic introductions, these writers convey much of the atmosphere of political turmoil among the Celtic peoples. Thus, Caesar: "In Gaul, there are factions not only in every state and village and party, but practically even in individual households." And Tacitus: "Once they owed obedience to kings, now they are distracted between the warring factions of rival chiefs." Implicit in comments of this kind lies the justification for conquest. Not only was such instability on Rome's borders intolerable to her, but also conquest and Romanization would bring peace to the benighted barbarians. The point is explicitly made in a set-piece speech which Tacitus attributes to Petilius Cerealis in AD 69, though in all probability it is the historian speaking. "Throughout the whole of Gaul, there were always despots and wars until you passed under our control. We ourselves, despite many provocations, imposed upon you by right of conquest only such additional burdens as were necessary for preserving peace. Stability between nations cannot be maintained without armies, nor armies without pay, nor pay without taxation. Everything else is shared equally between us." Tacitus takes a rather more realistic view when he puts into the mouth of the British war leader Calgagus, facing the Roman army in northern Scotland in AD 84, a damning indictment of Rome. Pillagers of the world, they have exhausted the land by their indiscriminate plunder. To robbery, butchery, and rapine, they give the lying name of government, they create a desolation and call it peace. While Caesar has a specific political agenda to achieve through his presentation of the Gauls, Tacitus uses the Britons and Germans as part of a general tirade against what he perceives to be the shortcomings of the Roman leadership. Modern decadence and indiscipline and the loss of individual liberty are his themes, and the Britons and Germans provide convenient characters through which to insinuate his views. The Celts are no longer a serious threat to Rome, it is the danger from within that is more destructive. For Tacitus, then, the Celts provide the allegory. From the end of the 1st century AD, barbarians other than the Celts provided the raw material for invective and polemic, and attitudes began to mellow as second and third generation Gauls and Britons became creative and influential citizens of the empire. Martial, born in AD 40 at Bilbilis, now Calatayud in Saragossa, Spain, several times proclaimed his pride in his Celt-Iberian origins. We who are descended from Celts and Iberians, and both Iberia and Gaul produced men of real literary talent. Only in occasional disparaging references to the northern Britons, such as Ausonius's epigram that matus, drunk, rather than bonus, good, is a more appropriate description for a Briton, can we see the old Celtic stereotype recurring. Oblivion and Awakening, circa 1500 to 1700. From the 4th century until the 16th century AD, the world cared little for Celts. The classical texts were largely lost or forgotten, and the universal appeal of Christianity, with its own texts, mythologies, and stereotypes, provided all the models that were required to order behaviour and to inspire origin myths and proto-histories. Yet it was Christianity that kept alive a knowledge of the Celts in the manuscript copies of the classical sources preserved in monastic libraries. In the 16th century, many of these texts began to become more widely available in printed form. The manuscript of Tacitus's Agricola reached Rome about 1470 and was published in Milan 5 to 10 years later, while Caesar's Gallic War was published in Venice in 1511. By the beginning of the 17th century, most of the major texts were available in their original languages and in translation. This coincided with a general awakening in Western Europe of the need to create national prehistories based on fact rather than myth. In Britain, the scholar John Leland began to collect data avidly on his travels throughout the country, while at the end of the century, William Camden produced the first serious attempt at explaining the early origins of Britain in his Britannia, first published in 1586. In France, the Celts were beginning to come to the fore in such works as Jean Lefebvre's Les Fleurs et Antiquités de Gaulle, published in 1534, and particular attention was beginning to be paid to the practices and philosophy of the Druids throughout the 16th and 17th centuries. The discovery of the New World, with its startling range of primitive peoples, each living in their own distinctive ethnographic present, and the beginning of the exploration of Africa and the East, provided ample comparative material for those writing about the prehistory of European society. Samuel Daniel could liken the tribal warfare of pre-Roman Britain to that of the American Indians, while John White could use his field drawings of Virginian Indians as models for Picts and Britons. What was beginning to emerge throughout the 16th and 17th centuries was the concept of the Celts, Gauls and Britons as noble savages, not unlike the soft primitivist approach of Posidonius. It was a trend which was to develop still further in the 18th century, after an awareness of the islanders of the South Seas enlivened the European consciousness. Celtomania and Nationalism, circa 1700 to 1870. By the beginning of the 18th century, the antiquarians concerned with early Europe had access to the principal classical texts, a varied array of ethnological analogies, and a growing knowledge of the prehistoric monuments and artifacts of their own countries. The three elements were combined, particularly in France and Britain, to create a vision of the past peopled by Celts and Druids. In Britain, the movement was led by William Stukeley, who began in 1723 to write a history of the ancient Celts in four parts. The work was never completed, but his two volumes on Stonehenge and Avebury, published in 1740 and 1743, ascribed both monuments to the British Druids,
In the wake of Stukely's energetic proselytizing, virtually all the megalithic monuments of Britain, tombs, circles, and alignments, were considered to be the preserve of Druids, while the hill forts were seen as ancient British strongholds, or as the camps of Caesar built during his expeditions in 55 and 54 BC. In France, the same enthusiasms prevailed. In 1703, Paul-Yves Peyson, a Breton priest, published his Antiquité de la Nation et de la Langue des Celtes, autrement appelé Gaulois. By the end of the century, the belief that the megaliths were Celtic were firmly entrenched in such works as Théophile Malot, Corrette de la Tour d'Auvergne's Origine Gauloise, and Jacques Cambry's Monument Celtique, which assigned all the Breton megaliths to the Celts. Another pursuit of those caught up in the romance of Celtomania was to discover Celtic literary traditions still extant in the folk memory of peasants living in remote areas. The most blatant case of invention came from Scotland, where James Macpherson created single-handedly the poems of Ossian, which he published between 1760 and 1763. This complete fabrication was to have had a profound effect throughout Europe in the fight for national identity. Ossian features large in the freedom poetry of the Hungarian Sándor Petőfi, nor were the Welsh free from romantic invention. In 1792, the ceremony of the Maen Gorsedd was created. It was held on the autumn equinox and involved Welsh bards in an extended performance of pompous ritual, heavy with symbolism, requiring for its props an altar and a circle of stones. The entire pastiche of an ancient tradition was the invention of the Welsh stonemason Edward Williams, who preferred to be known by his bardic name, Iolo Morganog. By managing to have the Gorsedd attached to the more ancient and respectable ceremony of the Welsh Eisteddfod in 1819, Williams ensured the survival of his nonsensical Celtic creation. In Brittany, folk memories and ancient songs were avidly collected by Theodore Hersart, Vicomte de la Villemarquais, whose Barzaz Braise, Songs of Brittany, was first published in 1839, at a time when the French government was attempting to wipe out Breton culture and language. He was roundly condemned by some of his contemporaries, who claimed that his songs were inventions, but his field notebooks have come to light showing that he had in fact recorded genuinely ancient material passed on orally among the country people over generations. The Celtomania of the 18th and early 19th centuries, with its mixture of facts and fantasies, has its place in the history of scholarship. It was a stage through which Western European antiquarianism almost inevitably had to pass, since it provided the first faltering attempts at bringing together classical sources, the study of antiquities, oral traditions, and language to create a European past. What is more surprising is that much of the romantic nonsense of this phase still persists. The French archaeologist Salomon Reinach, looking back over the outpourings of Les Celtomanes, could satirize their beliefs. The Celts are the oldest people in the world. Their language is preserved practically intact in Bas Breton. They were profound philosophers whose inspired doctrines have been handed down by the Welsh bardic schools. Dolmens are their altars, where their priests, the Druids, offered human sacrifice. Stone alignments were their astronomical observatories. He could afford to be scathingly dismissive, for after 1870, the results of archaeological activity throughout Western Europe were casting an entirely new light on the culture of the Iron Age. Beneath the romantic Celtism of the 18th century lay an undercurrent of nationalism which intensified and became more explicit in the 19th century. The classical sources provided a galaxy of national heroes: Boudicca in Britain, Vercingetorix in France, Ambiorix in Belgium, Viriatus in Iberia, all of whom could be used as symbols of national identity and freedom when required. The statue of Vercingetorix, erected at Alise-Sainte-Reine, Côte d'Or, in 1865, that of Ambiorix in heroic guise unveiled at Tongeren in Belgium not long afterwards, and the bronze Boudicca set up on the Thames embankment in London in 1902, were there to provide much-needed inspiration for creating national identity in the tumultuous century between the end of the Napoleonic Wars and the outbreak of the First World War. In much of this, France took the lead. The famous statue of the dying Gaul, bought at great expense by the French monarchy in 1737, was eventually transferred to France by Napoleon Bonaparte, on whom the potency of the image will not have been lost. Bonaparte established the Académie Celtique in Paris in 1805,
but it was left to Napoleon's nephew Louis Napoleon to initiate what must surely be the earliest planned research program in Iron Age archaeology. Returning to France after a period in exile, he was elected president of the Second Republic in 1848, seizing further power 4 years later to become emperor, thereafter styling himself Napoleon III. France had been through a long period of upheaval and was facing the threat of increasing Prussian militarism. Napoleon III was a scholar as well as being a politician and skillfully combined his personal academic inclination with the need to boost French morale by sponsoring a spectacular campaign of fieldwork and excavation to provide archaeological data for his projected work, the Histoire de Jules César. The fieldwork was undertaken between 1860 and 1865 by Colonel E. Stoffel with the aid of up to 300 assistants and labourers. The colonel's task was to research the topography of Caesar's campaigns and to identify the battlefields, an assignment completed with varying degrees of success, the highlight being the discovery and excavation of the siege works and battleground of Alesia, where the war leader Vercingetorix made his last heroic stand against Rome. To provide further Celtic background to these events, Napoleon initiated a large-scale excavation of the principal oppidum of the Aedui at Bibracte, Mont Beuvray near Autun, a task which he entrusted to J. G. Bouliot. Of the three projected volumes of the Histoire, two were published in 1865 and 1866. The foundation of Le Musée des Antiquités Nationales in Paris in 1863 ensured that his growing collection of Celtic antiquities, complete with models and reconstructions, would become readily accessible to the general public. In intensifying and possibly even creating public awareness of the Gauls and of their heroic resistance, the external aggressor Rome, Napoleon III was deliberately setting out to inculcate a national spirit. His attitude to Caesar was ambivalent. Caesar confronted Gaulish opposition, but he did so, Napoleon claimed, because otherwise the country would have been overrun by Germans. The parallels would not have needed stressing to the French public in the 1860s. But the Roman conquest also had the advantage of unifying Gaul during a long period of peace in a way never before or after achieved. When in 1870 Napoleon rode out at Sedan to lead the French army to a disastrous defeat at the hands of the Prussians, one wonders whether it was Vercingetorix or Caesar that provided his role model. The Romantic movement, which had gripped Europe in the 18th and early 19th centuries, provided a major stimulus to Celtomania in those regions which could claim to be Celtic. The discovery of poetic traditions like the Ossian epic invented by Macpherson and the nonsenses which sprang from the fertile imagination of Iorlo Morganwg should not detract from more serious work, such as Evan Evans's Some Specimens from the Poetry of the Ancient Welsh Bards, La Ville Marquise Barzaz Braj, or for that matter, the literary genius of Sir Walter Scott, whose novels and poems gave a new nobility to the Highlander at the moment when all things Celtic were being proscribed in Scotland. Out of this ferment of literary and folkloric outpourings, more solid structures began to crystallise. The foundation of the Society of Cymbradorian in 1751 and the Cambrian Archaeological Association in 1846 provided a sound academic framework for Wales, while in Scotland the Society of Antiquaries of Scotland was instituted in 1780. In Ireland, the Royal Irish Academy came into being in 1785, and the Royal Institution of Cornwall emerged in 1818. For the most part, these organisations provided structured forums where the like-minded could research and celebrate their past, but inevitably such societies provided, often unwittingly, an underpinning for nationalist sentiments, and the perceived Celtic ancestry offered a degree of unity. This was particularly developed in Brittany, where, in 1867, Le Vieux Marquis set up the first of a series of inter-Celtic congresses, to which were invited kith and kin from Wales, brothers from Cornwall, and cousins from Ireland and Scotland. It was from these roots that the Breton separatist movement, Braige Ato, Brittany Forever, was to grow in the interwar years. Pan-Celticism provided strength. It also offered an identity of otherness. We the Celts as opposed to them the French and English. This is nowhere better illustrated than in an essay written by the Breton priest-scholar Ernest Renan, The Poetry of the Celtic Races, published in English in 1896. The essay begins by describing the stark contrasts experienced by a traveller passing from Normandy into Brittany. A cold wind arises full of a vague sadness and carries the soul to other thoughts. The treetops are bare and twisted, the heath with its monotony of tint stretches away into the distance. At every step, the granite protrudes from a soil too scanty to cover it. A sea that is almost always somber girdles the horizon with eternal moaning. The same contrast is manifest in the people. To Norman vulgarity, to a plump and prosperous population, happy to live, full of its own interests, egoistical, as are all these who make a habit of enjoyment, succeeds a timid and reserved race living altogether within itself, heavy in appearance but capable of profound feeling and of an adorable delicacy in its religious instincts. The Celt as other, living in the wild extremities of Atlantic Europe, is a metaphor still very much alive today. The contribution of archaeology, 1870 to 1970. The growing awareness of the material culture of the pre-Roman Iron Age in the middle of the 19th century began to introduce a new realism into the study of late prehistoric Europe. But it was not until 1871 that the historic Celts could confidently be identified with the recognition that the cultural assemblages found in the graves of Champagne and the lakeside site of La Tène in Switzerland were closely matched by those associated with a series of burials inserted into the ruins of the Etruscan town of Marzabotto. Thereafter, the belief that the movements of people could be traced in the archaeological record gained wide acceptance, and the invasionist model became central to much archaeological writing. Material of La Tène type found throughout Central and Eastern Europe was directly related to the historic expansion of the Celts, though the extreme paucity of La Tène material in Greece and Asia Minor, where the Celts were known to have been active, was a salutary warning of the adage that absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. In the West, the situation was more complex. The study of ancient European languages had shown that forms of Celtic were spoken over much of the Iberian Peninsula, the British Isles and Ireland, and yet there was no historical record of Celtic migrations into these areas. It was, therefore, left to archaeologists and linguists to construct models of invasion from their two disparate viewpoints. Since each relied heavily on the other, a considerable degree of circularity developed in the arguments. In Iberia, the classical sources indicated a Celtic presence by the 6th century BC, and this was supported by linguistic arguments that suggested that the Celtic spoken in the peninsula was more ancient than that recorded in Gaul. Thus, it was incumbent on archaeologists to identify evidence for the Celtic migration from West Central Europe through the Pyrenees by searching out the material culture of the Iberian Late Bronze Age. This approach was most influentially propounded by P. Bosch Himpera in his famous paper Two Celtic Waves in Spain, published in 1939 in the Proceedings of the British Academy. In Britain and Ireland, invasionist theories were summed up in the elegant formulations of Christopher Hawkes, presented in a paper entitled Hill Forts, published in the journal Antiquity in 1931, in which a series of migratory waves were envisaged. Simple invasionist theories of this kind were in common use until the 1960s and are still found from time to time in the more popular literature. Their modelling was based partly on the classical accounts of Celtic movements, but also derived inspiration from an awareness of the migrations of the late Roman and early medieval periods. Behind it all lay the knowledge, gleaned from recent history, of the dramatic cultural changes, linguistic and material, that had been brought about by Western European imperial expansion across the world. This strengthened the implicit belief that cultural change was most simply to be explained as the result of folk movement. The Celts that emerged during this period still retained the image of the warrior intent upon feasting and raiding, in other words, the classical vision. But, in a century dominated by recurring war, much of it resulting from German militarism, a new image began to develop in which the Celt was given a more homely, creative guise in contrast to other barbarians, in particular the warlike Germans. In other words, the Celt was becoming domesticated. This was subtly and perhaps unconsciously achieved by putting increased emphasis on artistic and technical achievements and on the hearth and home aspects of the archaeological record. Such an approach was particularly well developed in Britain, where the creative originality of Celtic art had long been recognised, and where the extreme paucity of cemeteries producing warrior equipment forced archaeologists to focus on settlement sites and the productive systems that sustained them. The first recognisable ordering of the British agrarian landscape became known as Celtic field systems, and the term was readily, if inappropriately, adopted in the Low Countries and Denmark. The Celt of the period 1870 to 1970 is, therefore, a complex creation. In the image of the 19th century imperialists, he was prepared to fight his way into new territories, taking his women and children with him, but there to settle down to till the soil while the womenfolk spun, weaved and ground the corn. His love of art was well developed, and he was served by craftsmen of great originality and skill. Even his wife could add to the artistic ambience of the home by making pleasantly decorated pots. He was not unduly aggressive, but would fiercely protect his family and home if danger threatened. The discovery of a war cemetery at the gate of the hill fort of Maiden Castle in Dorset, attributed to the gallant Celts defending their settlement against Roman invaders, provided a potent image which caught the grim public mood in the late 1930s, and by the time that the excavation report was finally published in the depths of the Second World War, the war-mad Celt of the Poseidonian tradition had become Celticus domesticus. In France, too, opportunity for allegory was not lost. In 1949, in the aftermath of the Second World War, a monument was erected on the plain of Les Lommes below Alésia. It records, "On this plain, 2,000 years ago, Gaul saved her honour, pitting, at Vercingetorix's call, her peoples against Caesar's legions. After her reversal upon the battlefield, reconciled with the victor, united, defended against the invasions of the Germans, open to the enlightenment of Greece and Rome, she knew 3 centuries of peace." Celts at the end of the century. Since 1970, there has been a subtle change in the vision of the Celt, with an increasing emphasis on the economic systems which underpin society and with the use of world systems models. The development of coinage and the emergence of oppida, widely believed to be of urban character, are areas upon which much research has been focused. These developments were, in part, the result of a more widespread interest in economic structures among archaeologists, a trend which can be related to a much broader awareness of global economics occasioned by political moves towards a more united Europe. The pan-European image of the Celts was highly appropriate to this political imperative. The mounting of the spectacular exhibition, The Celts, The Origins of Europe in Venice in 1991, under the auspices of Palazzo Grassi and sponsored by the multinational Fiat company, is an example of the soft political use to which the Celts were being put. The point was explicitly made by the president of Palazzo Grassi in his introduction to the exhibition catalogue, The Celts. "This exhibition is a tribute both to the new Europe, which cannot come to fruition without a comprehensive awareness of its unity, and to the fact that, in addition to its Roman and Christian sources, today's Europe traces its roots from the Celtic heritage, which is there for all to see." It is in the light of this vision that one can best understand the initiative of President Mitterrand in providing lavish funds from the French state to support a new programme of multinational excavations at the Aiduan capital of Bibracte. In doing so, he was echoing the gesture of Napoleon III, though for rather different political motives. Jacquetta Hawkes summed it all up in the memorable thought that each generation gets the archaeology it deserves. Put another way, it is difficult, indeed impossible, to study the past without being affected by the transient values and aspirations of the moment. By attempting to understand the distortions wrought on the past by previous generations, we can be on guard against introducing distortions of our own and accepting those created for their own ends by our political leaders. Celts in the New Millennium. Programs of fieldwork and excavation across Europe daily produce new data relevant to the study of the historical Celts. The record increases at an exponential rate, and with it our understanding of the complexity and diversity of the European Iron Age grows to the extent that we must constantly question whether the term Celt has any ethnic or historical validity. I believe that it does, to the extent that there was a common shared language, versions of which live on in the western extremities of the continent. There were also shared belief systems and value systems, manifest in the surviving material culture, suggesting a high degree of connectivity over considerable areas, a connectivity explained in part by an innate restlessness leading at times to folk movements on a large scale. It was these mobile groups, from large populations on the move to small raiding parties, that the Mediterranean world came to know as Celts, Celt, then, is a term that may legitimately be used at a level of generalization, much as the names Iberian, Scythian, Greek, or Etruscan help us to construct intelligible historical narratives. One of the questions that had come to be debated in the last two decades is what can be said of the origin of the Celts. This issue has been studiously avoided in the past, perhaps because it cannot be answered with any degree of certainty. But one way to approach it is by considering the possible origins of the Celtic language in relation to what is now known about the early prehistory of Europe. This has led some scholars to suggest that the language may have developed early in the Atlantic zone as a lingua franca and later, perhaps in the mid-third millennium, to have spread eastwards into Western and West-Central Europe with the early Beaker movements. To what extent this hypothesis will stand up to close scrutiny remains to be seen. Much will depend on the results of current work on ancient DNA, which will enable population movements to be characterized and quantified in a way never before possible. But we must await a significant body of such data before beginning to create new historical narratives. What is certain is that our vision of the Celts will change, possibly quite dramatically, over the next decade. 2. Constructing the historical Celts. The concept of the Celts has many realities born of different disciplines. The earliest vision of the Celt was that created by the Greek and Roman writers, a stereotype based on close observation but simplified and highlighted in such a way as to form a generalized image easy to comprehend. By stressing certain aspects of appearance and behavior, these writers created a caricature of the barbarian other, different in every way from us who are civilized. This topos was translated into visual form in Hellenistic statuary, which became widely known across the Mediterranean world through Roman copies. The classical Celts were real to the people who created the concept. Endowed with motives, passions, and names, they were fearsome and alien, the very thought of them sending a shiver down the spine. The Celt of the classical authors served as a model for antiquarians in the 18th and 19th century, attempting to understand the past, but there was much new to be incorporated. A growing understanding of the languages of the Atlantic fringes of Europe, which from the early 18th century began to be called Celtic, introduced new complexities, not least the need to explain their origins. A little later, the vernacular literature of these Celtic-speaking peoples in Ireland and Wales came to be more widely known. In it, there were resonances of the world of the classical Celts, of chariots, feasting, and single combat, but much more besides. It was a febrile world of magic and uncertainty, with deities who could change shape at will always poised to interfere in the destinies of humans. Archaeological advances in the 19th and 20th centuries provided a new reality through the discovery first of the weapons and artifacts used by Celtic peoples, and later of the settlements in which they had lived and the detritus of the economies which had sustained them. Finally, in the 1930s and 1940s, the art of the Celts became recognized as a subject worthy of study, making it possible to bridge the gap between the classical vision, the vernacular mystery, and the somewhat mundane archaeological reality. The excitement of the subject is that it can be approached from these very different directions, all of which have validity within their own academic parameters. Yet what emerges presents an altogether different set of images. In the previous chapter, we considered the classical model and its evolution in broad outline. Here, it is necessary to explore in more detail the main classes of evidence that have helped to expand and modify that model. The Celtic language. Celtic belongs to the family of Indo-European languages. It is closest to the Italic languages, such as Latin, to such an extent that some linguists have postulated a common Italo-Celtic origin for both. This hypothetical group is believed to be broadly equivalent to two other European families, one from which the Baltic, Slav, and Germanic languages were to evolve, and the other ancestral to Greek. The point at which Celtic began to be distinguished is much debated. The more conventional view has, for a long time, been that Italic and Celtic separated and developed in the regions in which they were to flourish during the period 1300 to 800 BC, before outward migration of the Celts and the Latins in the first millennium. But more recent work, using computer modeling procedures to analyze standard vocabularies, has offered a different picture, suggesting that the Celtic language group first became distinguishable from the rest of the Indo-European languages of the European Peninsula around 4000 BC, and that the distinction between the Goidelic and Brythonic groups of Celtic languages took place about 900 BC. The implications of this new work will be considered in Chapter 3. Celtic languages are spoken now only in the extreme Atlantic periphery of Europe, but originally they extended in a broad swath from southwestern Iberia through Gaul and the Alpine region into the Middle Danube, with one group of settlers, the Galatians, introducing Celtic into Central Asia Minor, where, according to St. Jerome, it was still recognisable in the 4th century AD. The different types of recorded Celtic may be divided into two broad groups, continental and insular. Continental Celtic is known from the evidence of place names and personal names recorded by classical historians from coins and from a comparatively small number of inscriptions. Using this evidence, it is possible to distinguish four, possibly five, continental Celtic languages. In Iberia, Celt-Iberian was spoken over much of the centre, west and north of the peninsula. The earliest inscriptions date to the 3rd century BC, but the Greek writers record that Celts were to be identified in the region at least two centuries earlier. A recent study of inscriptions discovered in the extreme southwest corner of Iberia, written in Phoenician script, strongly suggests that the language transcribed was Celtic. The earliest of these inscriptions dates to the 8th century BC. In Gaul, the Gaulish language was spoken extensively in the 1st century BC and is well represented in 100 or so inscriptions. South of the Alps in the northwestern part of the Po Valley, a distinctive form of Celtic known as Lepontic has been identified in about 70 inscriptions. The earliest of these date back to the 6th century BC. Finally, in the Middle Danube Valley, place names and personal names indicate that the Celtic spoken here differed from the Western Celtic languages, but little is known of its structure or date, except that many of the names are no later than the 1st century BC. The insular Celtic languages were spoken in Great Britain, Ireland, and Brittany. It has been conventional to divide them into two groups: Q Celtic, or Goidelic, spoken in Ireland, the Isle of Man, and western Scotland, and P Celtic, or Brythonic, which forms the basis of modern Welsh, Cornish, and Breton. The long-established belief has been that Q Celtic was the older form and was adopted by the Atlantic communities at an early date, but was overtaken in Great Britain by the more recently evolved P-Celtic, which was the basis of Gaulish. It was further believed that Q-Celtic was reintroduced in Scotland and the Isle of Man by invaders from Ireland in the 3rd and 4th centuries AD, and that P-Celtic was reintroduced to Brittany by settlers from southwest Britain arriving in the 5th century AD. Recent work has, however, suggested that this model is probably a considerable oversimplification. It has been noted that P-Celtic place names are recorded in Ireland, though they may be transliterations of Q-Celtic names by P-Celtic speakers reporting them to the geographers of the classical world. The introduction of the Breton language poses more problems, and it is probably more in keeping with reality to interpret it as native Armorican P-Celtic, surviving beneath an overlay of Latin, reinvigorated by the similar language of the British settlers. A further factor to bear in mind is that the division between the two types of Celtic may be less significant than was originally believed. Awareness of the character of the insular Celtic languages emerged in the late 17th and early 18th centuries, inspired by the researches of the Oxford scholar Edward Sioed, assistant keeper at the Ashmolean Museum from 1687, and its keeper from 1691 until his death in 1709. As a true polymath, Sioed had many interests and skills, but it was in the field of comparative Celtic linguistics that he made his most lasting contribution. In 1695, he presented a prospectus for an ambitious publication to be entitled Archaeologia Britannica, which was to contain a comparison of Welsh with other European languages, especially Greek, Latin, Irish, Cornish, and Armorican. After extensive travel in the west of Britain and in Ireland, he returned to Oxford in 1701 to begin writing. The first volume of Archaeologia contains grammars and vocabularies of Irish, Breton and Cornish, with supporting discussions and etymologies. He noted the close relationship between Gaulish, Irish and British, and the similarities between Welsh, Cornish and Breton, but he did not systematise it as a QP distinction. In the Welsh preface to Archaeologia, as well as in the correspondence, he used his linguistic studies to put forward a scheme to explain the colonisation of Britain, suggesting that the Irish Britons were a colonial movement from Gaul who settled first in southern Britain. They were pushed out in the north of Britain and over to Ireland by a second wave of Gaulish settlers. In attempting to relate language through the careful study of etymology to people and migrations, Shud was formulating a model which was to dominate Celtic studies for 300 years. An alternative view, that the Celtic languages originated in the Atlantic fringes of Europe, will be presented in Chapter 3. Shud was working in one corner of the web of European languages. Already, a century before, Joseph Scaliger had divided the European languages into four groups, characterized by their word for God. Subsequently, various attempts were made to trace the European and related languages back to a common ancestor. In 1796, Sir William Jones, a judge of the Supreme Court of India, suggested in a lecture that language groups as disparate as Celtic, Gothic, Sanskrit, and Old Persian.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.